Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to my channel. Today we are going to take our discussion forward and talk about some aspects related to control. In the last class we discussed, in the last two classes in fact, we have discussed a lot of things related to control. And if you seem to like whatever I'm discussing related to control for the upcoming examinations, do subscribe to the channel and also don't forget to press the bell icon. So without wasting any time, let's start with the session and talk about, first of all, limitations of control. So we talked about advantages of control. Now we'll talk about certain limitations of control. What are the disadvantages or what are the limitations that control as a function has? Number one is external factors. There are certain external factors that I discussed with you that are not under the control of the management, and therefore when the management does not have control over them, the management does not have control over all these functions as well. Factors like government policies, technological change, fashion changes, social changes, etc. So let's say, picking up the older example, the standard was 100 bottles per day and my performance was 100 bottles per day. But let's say this difference in the performance is not due to my incompetence or the organization's incompetence, but this is due to certain social factor. Let's say I go to a bar every night, I go to a bar every night to drink, and the people there tell me, all the other employees from different organizations tell me that I should never comply with the standards that they have and try and underperform, because if I comply with the standard, they are going to raise it to, let's say, 150 bottles per day. So that social factor has a direct impact on how I work in my work environment, how I perform, and that external factor is not under the control of the management. So there are a lot of other external factors, for example, government policies. You must have seen in various communist nations and communist states around the world that the people don't perform that much. They believe that working their heart out, working their brain out is not very not a very good thing to do. It's not desirable, to say it accurately, and therefore they tend to underperform. So that is a basic assumption that I'm making here in this example. So a lot of external factors like government policies, technology, social factors, social environment can have an impact on the performance and is thus out of control of the management. This is done. The second is expensive process. Control is an expensive process because it requires quantitative and qualitative analysis of everything, starting from planning to directing, and therefore requires a lot of manpower, a lot of technological help, and a lot of time, and therefore it becomes an expensive process. Dampen spirit, excessive control. So this is not with respect to control, this is with respect to excessive control. If you're trying to control a lot, control above a certain limit, your employees or your team members, then they might lose out on the motivation part. They might stifle or dampen the initiatives that they have, that they might have when they join you. Therefore, it's very important to give them the freedom to perform. Control them up to a certain limit where it is positive and not to control them overly. So if we try to put it in the form of a graph, it might be like this. When you start controlling people, so there is this control over employees, and here you have performance of the employee. The performance of the employee would go up to a certain limit when you have optimum control, but then it starts going down because then you're showing signs of excessive control. Then you have control by exception, which is similar to or same as management by exception, and I've already explained that, so let's not talk about that and waste our time. And let's move to kinds of controls. There are three major kinds of controls: feedback control, which is post-mortem in nature; concurrent control, which is real-time in nature, to simplify them; and then you have feed-forward control, which is proactive in nature. So feed forward control is proactive in nature. In feedback control, you try to control the performance after something has already been done by having a post-mortem analysis and ensuring that the same mistakes or same underperformance is not repeated again. So it's a post-action control measure which results from completed action. So you complete an action, Your superior identifies your performance, compares it with the standard performance, identifies the differences, and then takes corrective action. In concurrent control, which is also a real time called as real time control, while you are performing, the superior or your supervisor is identifying your performance or measuring your performance and comparing it with the standard performance in real time basis, so that you don't have to wait, or the supervisor don't have to wait for the task to complete. It is normally followed when the tasks or projects are longer in nature, because let's say there is only one project, which is a long term project of let's say a year. So you don't, the supervisor will not get any time to correct your mistakes and make you redo it, because it's only a one time project. So what he does is he follows concurrent control, wherein in real time on a daily basis, he measures your performance and then clarifies whatever mistakes you are making. Okay. Feed forward is proactive, wherein before starting with your work, your supervisor is going to check how you're going to perform and also compare it with the standard. It involves evaluations on inputs, whatever inputs you provide him, and taking corrective measures before a particular sequence of operations is completed. Even before a task is completed, he checks on whatever inputs you provided, whatever your expected performance is, and then he tries to comply it or sync it with the standard performance. Okay, so these are the kinds of control. They are very important. They can be asked directly in the examination. So till now we've been talking about various features of control, advantages of control, limitations of control, functions which come under control, but we've not talked about the tools which can be used by the supervisor in order to exercise control. So how does the supervisor exercise control in reality? These are the five important tools that can be used by supervisors to exercise control over their subordinates. Number one is written reports. This is the most basic one, wherein you might also have gone through it if you've worked anytime in any organization. So in this, the supervisor demands written reports from the subordinate, and they also prepare reports on the performance on the subordinates and then submit them to the higher authority, which then takes a call as to what needs to be done with the subordinate, whether you need to fire him or her, whether you want to improve the performance of the subordinate if possible. So all those decision making activities are based on these written reports only. Second one is budget. This is normally followed only when you have a financial control, a financial demand for a financial control. So budget predetermines how much expenses you want to make or you can make, and then checks in reality how much expenses or expenditure have you made. For example, it goes on for the government also. So fiscal deficit checks the divergence between the actual money that the government had and the real expenditure that the government made. And that is where FRBM, Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act, comes into play, which tells the government, okay, you cannot be using all the money that you have and also borrow money from outside without any limitations. You need to have certain control measures, and FRBM through the parliament exercises that kind of control over the government. Okay. Third one is key ratios. There are a lot of ratios which can be used by organizations. If you've read about all these ratios, you would be aware, because these ratios talk about performance measurement of every organization in terms of profits or losses or returns on investment, so on and so forth. For example, if the target is 20% on profits, and if the organization is able to achieve only, let's say, 15% profit, then there needs to be a control measurement which would check why the organization was not able to achieve what it wanted to achieve. What were the reasons for this variance? Okay. Then there are certain accounting techniques like cost control, where, for example, CVP analysis, cost, volume, profit analysis. If you've gone through the finance numerical portion, you would have read about it. CVP analysis tells us the ratio between cost of a particular project or a particular good or service, the volume, the amount of good or service that is being produced, and the profit that is generated. And then you can measure it by comparing it with the standards of CVP and then checking the variance, identifying why the variance exists. Then you have internal audits. audit is basically identifying whether the organization has achieved what it wanted to achieve or not. So they're also called as operational audits, and they're very important for management control. They verify transactions. They can be on a real-time basis, which is called as concurrent audit, very popular among banks, and they can be internal, not real-time, but sequential audits as well, which are held every 3 months or every year, once a year. So the purpose of audits is to measure what is the variance between the standards and the performance and why these variances exist. Okay, so these are all methods or tools of control. Now, how individuals react to control? Till now, we've been talking about what is the control method, how can it be applied in the organization, what are the problems or limitations of control, what are the advantages, what are different tools, but we have not yet talked about the people who are being controlled. Okay, so in an organization, there is a supervisor or superior, and then there is a subordinate who is being controlled. And this supervisor is also being controlled by top management. So, because this supervisor is exercising control over the subordinate is expected to react. This reaction can be positive. This reaction can also be negative. Okay? And therefore, it becomes very important to understand and realize how individuals or subordinates might react to control, different kinds of control mechanisms. First is compliance, wherein the employee cooperates with the management and offer their compliance willingly. So these are the keywords that you have to remember. Questions can be formed around these keywords also. Cooperation comes in compliance, and it is also willing in nature. It is not coercive or force. Okay. Then there is deliberate deviation. Herein, the employee devises innovative ways of deviating from control and keep the deviations from being discovered. So herein, the employee is deviating, deliberate deviations. Here the employee is deviating, and at the same time is trying to hide the deviation as well. Then there is aggression, wherein the employee does not like it at all. The employees may show aggressive behavior against control. They try to sabotage the control to render them ineffective. So if the employee does not like it, he might go to a strike, he might stop working, he might actually cause harm to the tools or techniques which are being used in order to sabotage the entire process. Okay, there are multiple methods that could be used. That's purely customizable. The purpose or the keyword here is aggression, wherein the instead of complying or cooperating with the organization, with the supervisor, the subordinate is showcasing aggressive behavior and he's trying to sabotage the entire control process. Then you have apathy, wherein the employees may adopt an attitude of indifference against imposition of control. So apathy, keyword that can relate with apathy is indifference. That is where a question lies. That is from where the question can be asked in the exam. Then you have absenteeism. The next one, absenteeism, may absent themselves from the workplace to escape the controls temporarily. Pretty easy to understand. Then you have transfer. Employees may seek transfer to other departments to escape controls. Let's say the department of, let's say, production has heavy controls, but the department of accounting does not have any controls. So the subordinate, who is working in the production department but also can also get transferred to accounting, he knows accounting, he would want to get into accounting because there is no performance measurement which is happening there. And then you have resignation, which is the last resort, who do not accept controls and want to get some other suitable job which does not have similar kinds of controls. Okay, so these are all the methods of sabotaging or all the reactions, both positive and negative, that can be experienced by the subordinate. There is also group dynamics, wherein the employee forms informal groups to resist the pressure brought upon them by controls. So you are a group of employees who feel that the control is not positive, it is trying to curb your freedom, it is not contributing towards increased performance. You create informal groups, create a lobby for yourself, people who think who are like-minded, who think similar to what you think, and then they try and resist the pressure together. Okay, that's what happens in group dynamics, which is more like lobbying, or which is more like what happens in the trade unions in various organizations, trade unions and labor unions. Okay, then you have reasons for human resistance to change. So control is all about change. Control is very heavily or very strongly connected with change. Why? Because control demands that you understand and study your planning, organizing, directing and staffing process very closely, and you try and make changes based upon the changes experienced in the environment. So if the environment demands that you increase your performance because of heavy competition, you do that. Okay, so control flows from the top, and it's all about making change in the organization based upon changes happening in the external and internal environment. And people don't like change. A lot of people are very stuck upon the status quo, and therefore whenever there is a change, a lot of people start resisting that change, and that is why this becomes important to be discussed when you're talking about control. Control implies and involves a continuous check on the performance and behavior of individuals. Some individuals adjust with the control, whereas others resist control in one way or the other. That's what I said. So control may be perceived as curb on freedom. Why do people resist? Because they feel that their freedom is being curbed, is being affected. Control may suppress creative and innovative urges and abilities of the employees. If the employee feels that the control is suppressing his or her creative and innovative urges, then also they might either leave the organization or they might resist the change. The standard of performance may be imposed from the top, which normally happens in control, and subordinates have no say in their determination. Therefore, they may feel then the standard of performance is rigid, unrealistic, non-workable. So when we talked about control, we said that it has to be realistic and workable along with being flexible. But if the employee does not accept it as flexible and workable, if the employee feels that it is too rigid, it is too unrealistic, then no matter what you say, no matter how workable or flexible or realistic it is, they are going to resist that change. Okay. The control may be administered in a discriminatory, arbitrary and whimsical manner. So it's not always the reason that control acceptance is bad because of the fault of the employee. There might also be some faults in the way that control is exercised by the superiors. And therefore, if the control measure is exercised in a discriminatory, whimsical manner, which is arbitrary in nature, then also the employees will react negatively. Okay. How to overcome resistance to change? When you have resistance because of the control measures you are adopting, then the organization would also want to overcome that resistance. Okay, the control should be realistic and flexible. If it is not realistic, you make it realistic. If the employees do not feel that it is realistic, you make them realize that it is realistic and flexible. Okay, the control should give adequate emphasis to self-direction and self-control. Instead of controlling them from the top, you ask the employee, you ask the subordinate, what does he think an actual performance should be like in quantitative or qualitative terms, and then you can go forward and exercise or create a standard of control. For example, I just read it very recently and just realized it that this can be used here. There is a very famous director, I'm sure you must have heard about him, movie director called Woody Allen. Whenever he's on the set and whenever the actors are acting, after every session or after every take, he makes it a point to go to the actor and he asks the actor, what do you think about this? What do you think? Was it your best shot? Did you act as per the requirements? Do you think satisfied after this performance? If the actor says yes, then he's satisfied. The director is also satisfied that that's the best performance. So either I fire him or I let it go on if I'm not satisfied. Or if the actor is not satisfied, he himself comes up to the director and says, let's take another shot. So that's a kind of control method which makes acceptance the central. Acceptance is made the central idea behind control. The reward system of the organization should be integrated with control. So control should directly be integrated with the reward systems. The more the control, the more arbitrary or the more strict the control is, the heavier the rewards should be. For example, if you want to increase your performance, you also increase the pay of your subordinate. So he's directly motivated to either work with that rigid performance parameter or leave the organization. Okay? There should be two-way communication in the organization, again, boiling down to acceptance. The employee should be free to send their reactions and suggestions to top management so that they can vent out their anger. I hope you have understood it. Very simple to understand. Let's take certain questions now that we've finished the entire chapter. The first question says, XYZ Limited reported a net profit of 500 crore last year. This year, company targeted to achieve a net profit of 750 crore. Deviation acceptance is plus minus 6%. The rule of management by exception should be applied if 750 plus minus 6%. What is 6%? 6% is 45 plus, 45 minus. So management by exception says that it will come into play, or the top management will start looking at control measurements only if it goes beyond that limit. So if it goes beyond 705 or beyond 795, then the management will start looking at it. And if it is within 705 to 795, management will use management by exception and say that we don't need to look at it. I think it's fine. The supervisor can have a look at it. Okay. So therefore, the answer to this question is D, wherein the management by exception will be applied. That is, the management will not have a look at it and the supervisor will only tackle it when the net profits are between 705 to 795. Very easy question. Which of the following would be included in the controlling function? Which of the following are included in the controlling function? Explaining subordinates what needs to be done. Explaining, identify the keywords, explaining subordinates what needs to be done. Appraisal of employees' performance, performance appraisal. Guiding employees towards organization goals, guiding employees. Set a long-term organizational objective and measuring results. Okay, these are the keywords. Now, explaining subordinates what needs to be done is directing. Okay, it's not controlling. Appraisal of employees' performance, yes, part of controlling. Guiding employees towards organizational goals. Planning, organizing. Mostly a part of organizing. Set long-term organizational objective, this is for sure planning. Measuring results against organizational targets, again controlling. So 2 and 5 are controlling and all the others are other functions of management. So answer is D, 2 and 5. Let's come to the third question. Question says, people believe that control is necessary, but when it is exercised, they resist it because they think. So, what are the reasons of resistance to control or change? Control may hamper the creativity and innovative urges and abilities. Control may be discriminatory. Authority of decision making is dispersed throughout the organization. Dispersal of decision making. Controlling automatically applies McGregor's theory Y on employees. Performance may be imposed from the top and subordinates have say in their determination. So, these are the keywords that I've highlighted here. Why would they resist control? Yes, they think that control may hamper the creativity. Yes, if they think that control is discriminatory, they would try and resist it. If decision making is dispersed, they would never try and resist it. If control applies automatically to theory McGregor's theory Y, which is for the employees, they would never try and resist it. If they think performance is imposed from the top, yes, they might resist it. But if they have say in their determination, they would not resist it. So the answer is 1 and 2, A, 1 and 2. Let's come to the next question. Feed forward control system is a type of control system where, which one of the following is a feed forward control system? So if I show you the answers, you would anyways be able to identify what the correct answer is if I show you the options. So try and think before you get to the options, what a feed forward control system is, or what was the keyword that I had placed with feed forward system in order to help you understand and remember what a feed forward system is. Corrective actions are taken while program is still in operation. This is not feed forward. Control measures are taken after actions are completed. Again, not feed forward. Process of taking into account the changing planning premises, both external and internal, nothing related to feed forward. Action or performance is measured and is aimed at evaluating the performance as a whole or in different components, not related to feed forward. Evaluations on inputs are done and corrective measures are taken before a particular sequence of operation is completed. So this certainly is feed forward. I hope you have understood it. Which of the following correctly explains the nature of controlling function? Which of the following explains the nature of controlling function? So the purpose of all these questions is to help you understand what kind of questions are expected in the examination. These and certainly more difficult questions normally do come in the examination. Which of the following correctly explains the nature of controlling function? Management runs a business whose external environment keeps on changing. Managerial control must be dynamic. Control requires sufficient attention to be paid to observe the performance of subordinates. This requires an expenditure of a lot of time and effort. Controlling function is done at a point of time, which is incorrect because it is continuous in nature. Control also involves constant analysis of validity of standards, policies and procedures, which is also correct. So the correct answer should be 1, 2 and 4. Third is the only incorrect option that we have. Okay, so this is all about control that we talked about. If you like this lecture, do not forget to subscribe to the channel and also make sure that you press the bell icon. Also, share it with your friends on your social timelines so that more and more students can access these videos and take advantage and understand controlling in the best possible manner. All the very best. Take care.